morning, Open Door Baptist Church. Pretty day. Sunshine all day today. We're just so glad you're here. Glad to have you. If you're a visitor here at Open Door, I want to thank you for coming. My name is David DeLeon. They call me Pastor Dave around here, and we're just glad to have you. If you're logging on because you're watching the live stream of our service, we want to welcome you as well, and glad you could do that. I want to welcome Amy and Bill Vare. They are up here visiting from Utah for Amy's grandmother's funeral service, of course, is coming up this Saturday. And Pastor Dave Little, the other Pastor Dave, and Kathy Little are also up here from Florida. And so the memorial service is this upcoming Saturday for Louise Little. It's at 11 a.m. here at Open Door. And we're looking forward to that day. I really am. I'm looking forward to that memorial. It's just going to be a blessing from beginning to end. Don't forget that next Sunday on the 11th, we have a dish to pass following the morning service. Come and enjoy a meal. And then afterwards, we're going to have hopefully it's a short business meeting following the dish to pass. And no church service, just the meeting. We need to do two things: create a fund for the Parsonage Tube project, so that if you would like to fund it by way of offering, you've got to have a fund to put those offerings into. And then another purpose for that meeting: the missions committee would like to support John and Joanne as missionaries to this project in Arizona. They're putting a lot of their time in. They're renting a house. This is John always wanted to do this. He's hoping when he retired, he'd have the energy to go help pastors and do something for them in the name of missions. So the budget for this year allows for $1,200 to go towards a new missionary, and we're shopping for a new missionary to support. And the missions committee has a few ideas in mind about that, but they'd like to use $600 of that $1,200 to support John and Joanne. So we have to vote to release those funds for that purpose. And that'll be next week, okay? And then also we got the Teen Recharge Seminars coming up March 15th and 16th. All members are encouraged to help out with that ministry. So we have a sign-up sheet set up out there. Look over what you'd like to do to help with that. And I am quite certain you would be a blessing. All right, Pastor Zach.
All right, a few announcements is out in the foyer, there is a sign-up list for the Morrisville Outreach. If you've been here, you've probably heard us talk about Morrisville a few times. And this is something that we try to do a couple times a year, once each semester. Well, we're going to try to go to Morrisville in a couple weeks on the Valentine's Day week and have an outreach, tell people, pass out tracts, ask the students there how we can pray for them, use that as an opportunity to share Christ. And so there's a sign-up list out there. This week we're going to do something a little bit different. And on Monday and Tuesday we're going to actually have this outreach in the evening time. So those of you that maybe work throughout the day would like to be a part of this, but we're never able to because it was right during lunch. We're going to try this in the evening times. If you look out in the foyer, there's going to be times to sign up just for an hour. If you could sign that up, and that way we know how many people to expect. So Monday and Tuesday, we're going to be doing it in the evenings, and then Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday during the lunchtime time slot. So if you feel like the Lord is leading you into helping out in this area of ministry, to be a light in Morrisville, visit that. You can come talk to me, and I would be glad to give you some more information on that. Then also, teens, this coming weekend is our teen retreat, winter retreat. And so parents, right after the morning service, I would like to have a quick meeting over in the conference room. It won't be very long. This is for all parents of teenagers, not just if your teen's going on the winter retreat or not. So I'd like to meet with you guys right after the morning service over in the conference room. So please be back there after the service. And then one last thing regarding the teen seminars. Over by my door, I do have the sign-up list and all of the different areas of lessons that are going to be for the teens. So teens, if you want to take a look at that and then sign up if you're going to attend the seminars, please do so quickly. And then on there is also the amount that is pay. We need to get that off as soon as possible so we can get the discount. So teens, please see that. All right, let's go ahead and go to the Word. And we're going to look at Proverbs chapter 31, verse 30 this morning. Proverbs 31, verse 30 is our scripture reading. It says, charm is deceitful and beauty is passing, but a woman who fears the Lord, she shall be praised.
Let's pray. Father, what a joy to be in your house. What a joy to be with your people in the confidence that we are in the presence of your Son. And Lord, may your word just penetrate our hearts today, every one of us, as we think about the reality of eternity forever in Christ. We look forward to his return. May it be soon, but until then, Lord, may we find joy not only in the practicing of your word, but the encouraging of it with one another. May that happen even this morning in Jesus' name. Amen. We have a committee system here at Open Door that operates the ministry, various ministries at Open Door Baptist Church. And so we're in the midst of hearing about all of these committees. So the two committee promotionals this morning are both one-person committees. They don't necessarily have to be. That's the promotional committee and the gym and sports. So, Charlene, we will start with you.
Kind of funny. I'm here to promote promotional. And I am not a one-member committee anymore. Alyssa Brown reached out to me in December and said she would like to join promotional with me. So that's such a blessing to have her on, and a young person to help with some of the social media that we have going on now. So, but what does, for those that are new in at Open Door in the last decade or so, you might not even know what promotional does, the committee. The promotional committee is responsible to use various mediums to promote all ministries of our church with outside advertisement, inside promotional material. Our committee works with other committees to help promote the events that they are organizing or having at Open Door. The goal is to keep the name of our church out in our community for those who are perhaps looking for a church to attend or who are spiritually searching. So how do we do this? It has changed over my time. I've been the committee chair of promotional for quite some time, and at first it was a lot with the local newspapers, and we put many ads in the Casner Republican. But that's changed with the influx of social media and digital advertising. So we do still use Kes Republican for VBS, our Easter and Christmas services. But other than that, we don't use that a lot. But we do use Facebook. Kathy Bennett, she kind of has spearheaded a Facebook page for Open Door, and she updates that. Alyssa has an Instagram page for Open Door, which is private. So things that put on, pictures and everything, information, that is private. If you want to follow them, you just have to ask to follow, and she will, you know, allow you in. But it is that one's a private. And we make flyers, banners, digital invitations, and hard copy invitations for all sorts of things. So other committees, maybe you didn't know we existed. And if you are organizing an event, just reach out to Alyssa or I, and we will make sure you get what you need printed or digitized in whatever you need. Another thing we do is we keep our outside signage. I've been working on that for a while. Small little sign out by 13 was taken out in a car accident. Made blessing in disguise. And so we have this new, this is reflective, two-sided reflective. And so when car lights hit it, it will show up well. The cement is already poured to put it in. It's going to be on the corner near where it was, but a little up the hill more. And so a nice holder for this is being created, so this will be up at 13 within the next couple months, probably by the time maybe winter is almost done. Maybe before winter's done, because all they got to do, they're building it inside, it'll be metal, and it will be holding it like this. And but all they got to do is anchor it into the cement that's already poured. So, and we know we have a lot of wind here, so it's not going to be a blowing sign, it's going to be stationary. So, and the only thing else is if you have any suggestions or you see where maybe we need more signage, you have a suggestion of how we could promote our church more, we would love, you can reach out to me. One thing we are going to try to add this year too is a direction sign between when you pull in, like lower parking lot, main entrance. Just, you cannot over communicate to people, especially people that are unfamiliar with our church, just to give a little better directions outside. But just give us any suggestions that you have, and we'll keep promoting Open Door in this community.
Good morning. I'm Jared Lowson, for anyone who doesn't know me, and I am the chairman of the Sports and Gym Committee. The purpose of this committee is to create opportunities for fellowship and to glorify God through safe, healthy sports competition. Some of you might not have known that we have a gym and sports committee. I certainly didn't until a few minutes ago when someone told me I had to come up here and talk about it. That's not true, but we do kind of sit a little bit in the background compared to a lot of other committees here. We currently have one event that we hold on Tuesday nights. It's Open Gym Basketball. It's 7 p.m. It's a mixture of older teens and young adults and not so young adults. But we do have a number of things that we're going to try to do this year. We have a few minor safety-oriented repairs that we want to do in the gym. We want to try to get something going for youth basketball. That's little ones who can't quite make it up to the hoop yet. We've bought an extension that attaches to one of the hoops and will sit at a level that they can use. We're still trying to get it hooked up and attached properly, but we're hoping to have that, that here pretty soon. And then we'd also like to look into getting some more sporting events going regularly. We do the softball every year at the camp out. That's something that we could do in the warmer weather months. We have a new pickleball set, which I understand is quite popular with the seniors amongst us, so that's something we could get going. And then volleyball is something that I know we've done in the past that, that people enjoy. I am looking for someone to come alongside in the committee and maybe spearhead one of these other sporting events. As much as I would like to take another night off, I don't think Mrs. Lowson would be too keen on that. So I will be downstairs next to the donuts and coffee after the meeting. If anyone wants to come and chat with me or is interested in being involved in the sports and gym committee, I would love to hear from you. Thanks.
Appreciate one stanza. All right, let's stand together and just sing the first stanza of I'd Rather Have Jesus. The men are going to come get ready for communion at the same time. 506.
Sunday, typically we observe the communion table at the beginning of the month. It doesn't always work out that way, but we try to do that once a month. What in the world is communion? Well, I just want to remind you, this is simply a picture. It's a picture of a wonderful spiritual truth, and it is simply the truth that is rooted in the fact that all people are sinners. All people, everybody, is born into sin and practices sin, and sin is just anything which contradicts the perfect holiness of God. The things we think, say, and do that contradict the Lord, and the Lord can allow no sin into his holy perfection. Can't do that. Be like putting just a little bit of arsenic in your lemonade. Just a little bit. Except sin is to God, would be to God, a lot of arsenic to the lemonade. God can't allow that. He's perfect, he's holy, and so we are naturally separated from God. By nature, we are separated because of sin, and if unremedied, that will continue in forever and ever and ever. So God so loved the world, it says in the book of John, that he gave his only son, God the Son, Jesus Christ, who gave himself on the cross as a perfect payment for our sin. He died on the cross, went to the grave with our sin on his shoulder, and then because he is God, he beat death, and he conquered sin, and he conquered death at the same time. He rose from the grave, he lives today, and he presents himself as a gift. He offered himself as a gift to us on the cross. And to this day, anybody who believes in Jesus Christ, anybody who believes in Christ alone for the payment of sins, will have eternal life. It starts now, not when you die and go into the next life, but it would begin right now if you trust Christ today. I trusted Christ back in 1984. He has never let me go. He's offered me eternal life. I took it, and I have the confidence that I'll be with him forever. That's the reality of mankind and God who loves us all. So what is this about? Well, communion is a picture of that reality. The bread and the cup with juice in it are just pictures that Christ commanded that we observe formally as a time of reflection upon what Jesus did. So Christ isn't offering himself for your sins in this bread. He's not offering himself for your salvation in this juice. He already offered himself on the cross, and it was once for all, says the book of Hebrews. Well, this is what he says we are to reflect upon him with, just pictures. They picture a very wonderful and serious truth, but they are merely pictures. If you don't know the Lord Jesus, meaning if you have never put your trust and believe in Jesus Christ and believed on him so that you'll be saved forever, I encourage you to do that. If you haven't done that, then I encourage you to just observe what's going on here today. We're going to pass these plates, and just take the plate, pass it on. Nobody's watching you. No one's staring at you. This is an individual, private matter between you and the Lord. But this is for those who are reflecting on how God has saved them. So I encourage you, if he hasn't saved you yet because you haven't believed in him, just observe and get that right. And next month, when we do this again, you can partake as well. I'm going to ask Brian if he would ask the Lord's blessing on the bread.
Well, Father, Lord, we are grateful to be able to come into your house today and celebrate, Lord. Father, the gift that you gave so freely, the breaking of your body, Lord, the death on the cross. But, Lord, if that was it, what hope would we have, Father? You rose again. And Father, we are grateful for that, and we are thankful that one day you'll return for us. Father, we just ask you would bless this bread. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
in Jesus' very own words when he gave instructions on communion. He said, when he passed and broke the bread, "Take, eat, this is my body, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And then it says, in like manner, he took the cup. And the cup is a picture of the new covenant. It just means a new promise that Jesus made, that salvation is secure in what he did and not in anything we do. You have eternal life because of his work on the cross, not because of any work we offer to him. That's the new covenant. So I'm going to ask Gary if he'd ask a blessing on the cup.
Dearest God, we just thank you for this time to be together. We thank you for your holy presence with us here today, dear God. And we pray that you just help us to understand the price that you paid in your shed blood on the cross. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
And then it says, in the same manner, he, Christ, also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant or promise in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Once a month, just to formally reflect on our Savior and what he's done for us. This time we'll have our gentleman come forward, just special music on the guitar.
Ain't justified, oh blessed thought, and sanctified salvation wrought. Thy blood hath poured and bought for me, and glorified I too shall be. Complete in thee. Justified, oh blessed thought, and sanctified salvation wrought. Thy blood hath poured and bought for me, and glorified I too shall be. Complete in thee, no more shall sin. Thy grace hath poured rain below. Thy blood shall be the tempter. Savior, when before thy bar all tribes and tongues assembled are, among the chosen I shall be at that right hand, complete in thee. Yea, justified, oh blessed thought, and sanctified salvation wrought. Thy blood hath poured and bought for me, and glorified I too shall be. Yea, justified, oh blessed thought, and sanctified salvation wrought. Thy blood hath poured and bought for me, and glorified I too shall be.
Thank you, man. Amen. We are in the book of Song of Solomon, otherwise known as the Song of Songs in the Old Testament. Have you ever come in, turned on the TV on a good movie halfway through? One of my favorite movies, a Western, of course, Conacher, portrayed by Sam Elliott, came out in 1993. I came home, I turned on the TV and caught the last 20 minutes of Conacher. It was riveting. That last 20 minutes flew by all the way to the end. I couldn't take my eyes off the screen. And when it was all over, I thought, wow, who were those guys shooting at him? And what was his problem? And who is this woman? And how did they connect? And I had all kinds of questions with no answers. Why? I came in the middle, or at the end, really. So I waited until it came on again. It was on cable, so it was just a matter of time. And I watched it from the beginning and got all of my questions answered. Unanswered questions usually results in wrong conclusions. Well, when it comes to physical intimacy, which is the theme of the Song of Solomon, wrong conclusions can just be disastrous, right?
Now, with this song, last week we just got the introduction, and the plan is to start at verse 1 and go from there. However, before we do that, there is an underlying theme that prefaces this entire song, okay? And the preface starts at the beginning, so to speak. Starting at the beginning answers questions. Answered questions results in right conclusions. This preface is found in three texts. One at the beginning, one a little further in, and then one that comes up at the final chapter. First time this text shows up is chapter 2, verse 7. It says, I charge you. It's like saying, I command you. O daughters of Jerusalem, by the gazelles or by the does of the field, do not stir up nor awaken love until it pleases. Now if you go a little further into chapter 3, verse 5, it says, I charge you again. O daughters of Jerusalem, by the gazelles or by the does of the field, do not stir nor awaken love until it pleases. Then if you go all the way to the end of the book, chapter 8, it's almost identical. In chapter 8, verse 4, it says, I charge you, O daughters of Jerusalem, do not stir up nor awaken love until it pleases. Now this is a command to take an oath. A command to take an oath. Rarely do you find a command to take an oath in Scripture. In fact, we're told to be very careful about taking oaths, right? But here we're commanded. We see a command. Somebody's being given a command to take an oath. And they're to do it by gazelles and does of the field. In other words, it's like when you say, I take an oath, I swear, on my mother's grave. That's how serious I am and how truthful I am. And on my mother's grave, I take this oath. Or I put my hands on the Bible and the holy word of God, I swear. And what he's saying is take your command or swear by the gazelles and the does of the field. What? How does that make anything important? Remember, this book is poetry and it uses really picturesque word pictures. Like the line from the 1970s love song. It says, money talks, but it doesn't sing and dance and it can't walk. As long as I can have you here with me, I would much rather be forever in blue jeans, babe. We're just saying what? Very poetically, that I would much rather live in poverty with you than to be a wealthy man without you. Of course, that was written back when blue jeans were a common man's pants. So we'd have to change the metaphor today because blue jeans have gotten expensive. It seems like the more worn out they are, the more expensive they are as well. So, but that's the idea behind here, is this poetic. You say, well, how are gazelles and does poetic? Well, the Hebrew that this was originally written in has a word that is an antonym. That's its one word with two meanings. And the word is, it refers to gazelles, but it also refers to armies. Same word. Could be referring to gazelles, those cute little deer, or it could be referring to armies usually used in the Old Testament as the armies of the Lord. Same word. And then the Hebrew word or words for does of the field, this is a play on words. Those words are pronounced El Shaddai, which sounds very similar to the Hebrew word El Shaddai, which is my favorite description of God, God Almighty. I love that word. The psalmist is using this as a play on words. This is a really poetic way to say, I command you by the lords of the armies and by God Almighty, swear this oath. Makes a lot of sense, doesn't it? And just what is the oath? It is a command to, notice, not stir up love nor awaken love. It's a command to not stir up nor to awaken love. That's what he's commanding here. And, you know, love is used in different ways. There's actually multiple words in the Bible for love. They're just all translated into English with the same word because we only have really one English word that we use for all different kinds of love. And we got different kinds. For instance, I'll say, I love the desert where I grew up. I love canoeing. Paul Little loves Little Debbie cakes, right? There's a love that a mom has for her children. There is a love that we are supposed to have for one another. Which is also the same kind of love that God has for us when it says, for God so loved the world. And so we have all these different words for love that we all use the same word to describe them all, which creates humorous situations for children. And you just say,
Paul Little loves Debbie cakes. And little children say, Paul loves Debbie cakes. He wants to marry him. And we say, no, it's a different kind of love. And you're just not understanding. Well, Scripture clarifies there are different types of love. The most common type of love in Scripture that is used of God's love for us and the love we're supposed to have for each other is the kind of love that seeks the highest interest in somebody else with the expectation of zero in return. You cannot pay back God's love for what he did for you on the cross. Salvation is not earned. It's a gift. It's free. And God sent his son to the cross. Christ went to the cross knowing we would never pay him back. We accept the free gift, but we can't pay it back. This is the way we're supposed to love each other. Is that the kind of love in this command to not stir up or awaken love for it pleases? Probably not. That kind of love should be stirred up, always, always awake. This is a different kind of love in the psalm. The nature of this entire psalm indicates that this love simply means the passionate desire for physical intimacy. That kind of love. That kind of love burns, and it burns hot, and it's really hard to extinguish. Do you know why? It was not designed to be extinguished. This love was meant to burn in its rightful time all the way to its conclusion. Okay? That's right. This kind of love has a place. Until it pleases. He said, don't stir it up before it's time. That is, don't stir it up until it pleases. That means when this love burns to completion. When this love burns. When physical intimacy is allowed to take place with a clear conscience. The command is, don't stir up the desire for physical intimacy until that intimacy is allowed to burn. Well, that begs the question, what do we learn from this? Okay? What do we learn from this command, this oath to take? Number one, there is a proper time for physical intimacy. There is a proper time. Remember what I said last week? Sex is not a bad word. It's what God created for a proper time. And when is the time for physical intimacy? First of all, within the confines of marriage. Within the confines of marriage. This is seen throughout this entire song, which is between a husband and wife. This is seen throughout the entire scriptures, even though it's violated throughout scripture, it is violated all over in the world. This is seen even in the design of marriage, as spelled out in Genesis chapter 2, with the creation of Adam and Eve. You want to understand how something is to be used, understand what its purpose for design was. Why was it designed? If you see me using a torque wrench, which is a precision mechanics tool, and you see me using it to drive nails, you know that's wrong if you know what the torque wrench is designed for. You know, I'm going to destroy the thing. You want to understand physical intimacy? Understand the design of marriage. All you got to do is look at Genesis 2. God created one man for one woman to be united in a marital commitment for as long as they both shall live. When you understand that design, all these other misuses of marriage and physical intimacy are clearly outside of the design. You don't need any other scripture to tell you that. So within the confines of marriage, physical intimacy is absolutely appropriate and not a bad word. When else? When else is the time for physical intimacy? Number two, when both husband and wife agree. This comes from 1 Corinthians 7:5. Do not deprive one another, husband and wife. Do not deprive one another of physical intimacy, except with consent for a time. You got to talk about this. Husbands and wives, communicate. Okay? It says that you may give yourselves to fasting, prayer, and then come together again so that Satan doesn't tempt you because of your lack of self-control. So this whole idea that intimacy, whenever you want after marriage, guys, that's a false teaching. Oh, it's for marriage whenever I want. No, it isn't. Because what that does is that makes intimacy a taking thing, when the truth is, like all other aspects of love, God meant intimacy to be a giving act, you see? And when it simply becomes taking, husbands start to make their wives feel used, and then wives start to use intimacy like a weapon and a tool, like throwing a dog a milk bone if he behaves. Right? Now, there's a proper time for this, folks. Here's what else we learn from this command And remember, you know, this is a command to take an oath. I charge you, daughters of Jerusalem, do not stir up nor awaken love until it pleases. Second teaching we learn here is this teaching is geared towards the young ladies. Daughters of Jerusalem, these probably would have been the maidens in the palace of the king. Okay, they were unmarried maidens. That's why this is a preface. Now, of course, this command applies to you men as well, but make no mistake, it's directed toward the ladies who are not yet married. That is a wonderful and good state to be in, ladies. There's nothing wrong with that. They are the primary audience of this book that God wrote. This is God's word. And he's targeting you who are a lady, not married. Whether you're young, whether you're not so young, makes no difference. It's targeting you. And there is absolutely nothing wrong with singlehood. Should not be asked of one of our unmarried girls, when are you going to get married? As if somehow there's something wrong with being single. There's absolutely not. Okay? But guys, just saying, complete in thee, complete in Christ. Your completeness as a human being doesn't come in whether you're married or single. It comes in Jesus Christ, your Savior. And so there's nothing wrong with that. In fact, the Apostle Paul said, if you have a heart to serve Jesus as your Savior, being single gives you an edge and an advantage that he had, and he really appreciated it. He said, if you have that edge, make the most of it. But it is directed to the young ladies in this text. Why is that? I'll tell you why. Because ladies have more power to awaken and stir up love than men do. They have a lot of power. Oh, yeah. Generally speaking, for a male to awaken this kind of love in a female can be like trying to start a fire by rubbing two sticks together. You ever try to start a fire that way? Okay. I've tried. I've gotten a couple of maple branches. Well dried out, even made a bow drill, all of this in a controlled environment over in the garage. And I tried to do this, make this happen. Made smoke, never got flame. You know, if my plane goes down in the middle of the nature and I got no matches, I'm in trouble. All right? It is hard to do. But the reverse is not true for men. See, for a female to, generally speaking here, for a female to awaken love in a male, kind of like starting a fire by throwing gasoline on hot coals. And the reason for that is females usually have an on-off switch. Males don't. They're just always on. Now, the flame's not always burning, but the coals are always hot, so all it takes is a little bit of unleaded. You got flame. So for a female to awaken love, she just needs a little bit of effort. Okay? That's the kind of power females have, which is why they're the target audience of this instruction and this command. And maybe some of you young ladies didn't know that about yourself, or maybe you did and you're using it. In this text, the command is given to those who are unmarried and have thus preserved themselves. And I know, you know, maybe you sacrificed that purity. Hey, God is a God of forgiveness. And you can't recapture the past, but you can start with his forgiving restoration now and go from there. For those of you who are unmarried and have preserved yourself and have not crossed the line into physical intimacy, that's why this is a preface for you. You're starting the way you're supposed to start. And the majority of this song is actually how to love your spouse. But first, till you have a spouse, you gotta learn not to awaken love prematurely. Which is why you need to know this, young ladies. You're the target audience. Now, some of you parents are saying, that's just great, Pastor Dave. You just told my daughter about a power that she has. Well, maybe somebody should, lest she awaken love prematurely. Or worse yet, awaken it deliberately because nobody ever warned her about the dangers. Just how do the females awaken love prematurely? Well, there's three ways, generally speaking. First of all, by way of flirtatious talk. Flirtatious talk. Sometimes we think that flirting words are cute and innocent. Absolutely, they're not. Flirtatious words are leading words that awaken love. Now, are such words ever acceptable? Yes, between a husband and wife. Chapters 1 and 2 of the song have a whole lot of flirtatious talk. between a husband and between a wife, right? But outside of that union, they're dangerous. Now, those of you graduated high school, do you have your annuals? You still keep your yearbooks? You remember when you'd go around and have people sign your yearbooks? Go home, open up your yearbook, and look at what people wrote to you back then. I suggest you have a black marker in hand so you can blot out the things that those boys or girls of the opposite sex wrote to you before your children and grandchildren read them. Would you believe what this boy said to grandma in her yearbook? You don't want them reading that stuff, because flirtatious talk is real easy to do, and it fires up and stirs up this kind of love. Another way that this love is stirred up and awakened is by flirtatious touch. Flirtatious touch. Now, it is innate that singles want a physical relationship with someone. That is one of the huge draws in marriage for those who are preserving themselves. But because of this desire, the question is often asked, before marriage, how far is too far? Is kissing too far? Is hand-holding too far? Is this too far, that too far, etc.? As if somehow we're supposed to give you a list. Say, this is the acceptable list and this is not. See, that's the wrong question. Remember, we often formulate wrong answers because we have wrong questions. This formulating questions from our desires is actually formulating them from a mindset of, what can I get away with? Here's what I want to do. Now tell me, what can I get away with to get as close to that as possible? Wrong question. When you allow the scriptures, the word of God, to formulate your questions, you ask the right questions, then you get the right answers. Okay? So how far is too far is the wrong question. In light of the command here, of this oath, the right question is, does this touch awaken love? Does it awaken and stir up in me something that I'm not going to be able to extinguish very easily? Okay? See, now when you ask that question, the right conclusion should be a no-brainer. Any touch that would awaken love is going too far. Simple as that. Because remember, not being married, you're not ready to let this kind of love inflame and burn all the way. So whatever touch does that, withdraw. That may mean no touch. Now, some of you are looking at me and saying, Pastor Dave, you are being unrealistic. Am I? I'm just coming at you from God's instructions in this song. Whereas I think many, many people come from the world's influence on what's acceptable and what's not. Remember what I said last week? That the world says sex before marriage is no big deal. Therefore, the things that lead up to sex, those are no big deal either. Well, God says they are if they awaken love. And then the third way in which the females can awaken love prematurely is by flirtatious threads. Clothes. Thread starts with T, so I ran with it. Yeah, it's been said, and I think there might be something to this. You really want to shut people down? Start picking on their choice of clothing. And if it doesn't shut you down, it sure gets your attention, doesn't it? And evidently, God doesn't mind getting our attention in this way, because speaking to the ladies in the book of 1 Timothy, chapter 2, verse 9, and remember, this is especially in the context of church attendance, because Timothy was the pastor at the church in Ephesus. Paul wrote this letter to him to guide him in his role as the pastor, and he says, here's how you lead, how you lead God's people here. So through his instruction, he talks to the ladies in Timothy's church, and he says, in like manner also, the women adorn themselves in modest apparel with propriety and moderation. Modesty, propriety, moderation are to guide the ladies' clothing. Now, granted, the measure of these qualities fluctuates with culture, doesn't it, and history. For instance, in the what we would call the Victorian era of the 1800s, women dared not go to church or even be seen anywhere in public without a skirt that dragged on the ground, okay? Any part of her feet or legs were not to be seen. And of course now in our culture, you know, ladies are perfectly modest in feminine dress slacks. There's nothing wrong with that. So that's a cultural thing, and we understand that. But again, the real problem lies in asking the wrong questions when it comes to clothing. When we ask, what's wrong with this dress? Or what's wrong with this skirt length? What's wrong with wearing a halter top? Right. The right question is simply regarding any clothing that you wear is, does this garment awaken love? Does it stir it up? And yes, ladies, some garments do. Okay. What kind? Well, based on the principles of modesty, which includes decency, the kind that awakens love is simple, the revealing kind. Simple as that. Clothing reveals in two ways. First of all, clothing reveals skin. I read somewhere, a woman in a bikini reveals about 90% of her skin. And aren't men so polite that they only let their eyes go to the unrevealed parts? Well, that reveals a real truth. The more skin that is revealed, the more the eye is drawn to places where it should not be drawn to. Clothing reveals skin. And then secondly, clothing reveals form. You know, a woman can be completely covered and yet still leave almost nothing to her form, to the imagination. I read this, that it has been said, the following three tell the blatant truth: drunks, children, and yoga pants. They hide nothing. And skin-tight clothes, well, they reveal all. And again, it draws the eyes to where they're not supposed to go. Now listen, men, you are not excused. You cannot say, well, you know, it's her fault the way she dresses. Well, no. Like Job, you have a covenant to make too. You have an oath to swear, one with your own eyes. Put blinders on. How? Well, number one, you don't go looking for sights that you shouldn't be looking at. Come on, guys, let's get careful, all of us, me too, about what we watch, about what we log onto. Okay? But also, you got to be kind of like a Minuteman and be ready to put your eyes on defense when something unexpected presents itself, especially in our culture during the summertime, right? Or where I grew up in Phoenix, Arizona, all year long. You got to be careful. King David failed at this when he was on top of the palace top and he looked down at Bathsheba, who was bathing on her rooftop. He didn't go into defense mode and put those blinders on and get out of there. Men, that's your responsibility to do that. It's just too bad that men across our nation have to put their eyes on defense even when they go to church. Church is a place where believers are supposed to edify one another, not tempt one another. Ladies, it's really not that hard to figure. Because if you have an item of clothing that you just question, you're not sure of, you know, put it on. You look in the mirror, and it's just you and the Lord in the room, and that's it. And you ask, does this clothing awaken love? Now, if you answer honestly before the Lord, then whatever your answer is, if it's yes, it does, or no, it really doesn't, then you'll know what to do. Simple as that. A lot of dads, especially Christian dads, trying to instill the sense of purity in their daughters, will do what is called giving them a purity ring. They give their daughter this ring. Say, I want you to wear this ring as a commitment to maintain your purity and maintain your virginity until you are married. Yeah, I don't think that's a bad thing at all. If I had a daughter, I sure like this idea. I would do something like that. But I would take it one step further. Because, you know, it's possible to maintain your virginity and still awaken love in somebody else. People do this all the time. I would encourage the young ladies, take this oath to not stir up love at all, and your purity and virginity will take care of itself. You see, then maintaining your virginity before marriage is no longer the goal. It is simply a wonderful benefit of the goal. The goal is, don't stir up love. Love people appropriately, not inappropriately. That is one of the many, many benefits of simply living God's way. And I would say that alone makes this an oath worth taking. Father, we just are just sinful people saved by a righteous God, the only righteous God. We thank you. Lord, we know we cannot do things to earn your love. We cannot follow your commandments to get on your good side. Lord, we can only obey you because we are first saved by you. And so may we, everybody in this room, man, woman, young, old, may we just commit to following after you because you have saved us. And obey obey you even when it is hard and it goes against our grain. We need you and your grace to do this, and I thank you for this opportunity to be with your people. May we edify each other, build each other up in truth. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm going to have Jason come and lead us in our closing song, past song of the month. Yet not I, but through Christ in me. He makes all this possible. Jason.
Please join me in standing one more time as we close our service with this song. What a great song. Choosing Christ.
What gift of grace?
Great afternoon. Enjoy the sunshine. See you tonight.